What's up, karate nerds? In today's video, we're gonna rank the top 10 kata across all of karate to determine which ones are the most worthwhile for you to practice. And we're gonna choose the katas from the official list of the World Karate Federation. I would say that this list consists of like 95% of kata that are worth knowing. The way I'm ranking these kata is both from a functional application perspective, meaning how useful are these movements in actual self-defense, but also how good of a workout and motor intelligence development is it to actually know this kata, meaning from a biomechanical standpoint, how much does it actually develop your physical capacity, your balance, coordination, stamina, endurance, and all of that. Combined, this creates the overall scoring that I'm gonna be using for these kata. And the first kata that I'm choosing is, drum roll please, Shatanyara Kushanku. This is an epic kata. Here's what it might look like. Each of my 10 picks, you're gonna see a performance of the kata, and I'm not rating the performance, I am only rating the kata in itself. The only reason I'm showing you a performance is so you can understand what I'm actually talking about. And let me tell you, this kata is one of the most challenging ones to perform. At the middle of the kata, you're doing that jump, right? And you're exhausted by that point, but then you still have the second half left, plus another jump kick at the end. And there are very few people in the world who can do this at full speed without losing any movement quality as they perform it. And let's not forget the practical applications of this kata. It is like the master kata at the top of the mountain, especially for the Okinawan Shoryu based styles like Kobayashi Ryu and Matsubayashi Ryu and so on, or for more modern Japanese styles like Shito Ryu. So it's truly a worthwhile kata to practice. I'm probably gonna put Shatanyara Kushanku at the very top because this is such a challenging, complex, and interesting kata. Plus, it's one of the more traditional ones. The other Kushanku or Kanku, Dai, and Sho versions of this kata actually come from the original one in Okinawa. We're moving on. Next kata, let's see, is, here we go. Gankaku. And the original name for this kata is actually Chinto, but in modern styles like Shotokan, it's referred to as Gankaku because Funakoshi Gichin, one of the pioneers of modern karate, changed the name of this kata and many other kata. And that's why it also looks a little bit different compared to its original form. And here's an example of what it might look like. This kata is truly challenging for the fact that it combines fast and sharp movements with those super slow moments of stillness. So you need to have a lot of movement in the body, but stillness in the mind. Otherwise, you will lose your balance at those crucial moments where you need to stand on one leg. Plus, it has a jump kick with your left leg. And if you're a right leg person like me, well, then that's even more challenging. So I'm gonna put it at a solid A. And besides, if you look even further back at the original version, specifically the version that comes from the Tomari region in Okinawa, then you will find lots of juicy practical applications. So I'm gonna put it at an A. Now back to the list. My third choice is probably gonna go, I gotta go with Sanchin, because this is what many old masters consider one of the most important kata in all of karate. Because it teaches you so many important attributes that kind of build the foundation of your other kata. It's sort of a basic kata, not in the sense that it's easy or anything or not important, but in the sense that it's fundamental. It's a building block for good karate. It's a cornerstone of many styles. This is what Sanshin looks like. As you can see, Sanshin is specifically focused on breathing mechanics, which is super important because your breath is that pathway between your mind and your body. And that's just one of the many things, including your posture and alignment and stability that Sanshin Kata teaches you. That's why there's an old saying that everything is Sanshin and Sanshin is everything, because it is within every other kata. The better your Sanshin is, the better all your other kata will be. That said, it is not the ultimate kata in any way. It is just very specific in what it develops within you. So I'm not gonna put it as high because, let's face it, it's definitely not a cardio or anaerobic lactic acid workout, but it is very important. So I'm gonna put it at a B. Let's see which one to pick next. Now I'm gonna do something similar to Sanshin, Naihanshin Shodan. And there are many ways to spell it, sometimes with an F, sometimes with an H, doesn't really matter. Other styles like Shotokan know this as Tekki Shodan. And you might be wondering why I'm choosing such a basic or simple kata. It's because it develops your power, more specifically lower body stability combined with upper body mobility. It is very short and sweet with some brutal practical applications. And this is what it looks like. Since this kata is also considered one of those important fundamental kata of old school karate, I'm gonna put it next to Sanshin at the B level. Because just like Sanshin, its lessons are present in every kata. I would definitely put it even higher if it had more planes of motion and if it incorporated more of those Sanshin breathing type movements and was a little bit longer and more challenging. Back to the list, and in this case, now it's getting more difficult. I'm probably gonna go with Nipai Po. Nipai Po is one of my favorite kata. It actually comes from the white crane kung fu style of southern Fujian province in China, where I had the pleasure of even seeing the original form when I went there to rediscover the lost roots of karate. This is what the karate version looks like. Thank you. Nippaipo is one of the few kata that still remain in karate that have a visible and easily traceable white crane kung fu lineage. And for this reason, I think it's very important to preserve it. And it is super fun to practice. It has a lot of these weird kind of one knuckle punch techniques, the Ipponken, you know. And it also has that classic hakutsuru, the white crane movement, where you're standing on one leg. Which of course is what inspired the Karate Kid crane kick. So it's a really cool kata, both from a technical, historical, and cultural standpoint. And so for this reason, I'm gonna put it at A. We're halfway there, only 5 kata left on this list. So next is gonna be Suparinpe. This is one of the longest kata that exists across any karate style. And the reason is not because it has the most movements, it actually has quite few movements that you just repeat them a lot of times, and you have a lot of slower pauses and stillness within this kata. So just check this out. Traditionally speaking, this kata is considered one of the highest and most advanced ones in styles like Goju Ryu, for example. But Suparinpe is not as complex as it may seem, because like I said, you're repeating the same movements in all 4 directions, like over and over again. And for this reason, I'm actually gonna put it at B level. And trust me, if you show this to somebody who doesn't practice karate, they wouldn't be that impressed. It is quite boring unless you understand what you're looking at. That being said, it is one of my favorite kata. Let's see which one I'm gonna choose next. I'm probably gonna go with Unsu or Unshu, as it's originally called. Different styles have different pronunciations. It doesn't really matter. You can even spell it differently. Here's what it looks like. This kata was originally handed down in Okinawa by Adagaki Seisho, a very famous local expert, and it is one of the few kata that actually teaches you how to defend yourself on the ground, which I consider very important. Besides, it has a really badass jump at the end. I'm gonna put it at the very top of my list. And just for fun, I'm gonna use the original spelling, because the name actually translates to cloud hands, which refers to these movements where you separate your arms several times in the kata. And this movement is still being seen in many old school Tai Chi and Kung Fu styles, and it is very useful. And that's why they call this kata Cloud Hands or Unshu. Just a fun side note. Only 3 kata left. Oh my god. Okay, let's see which one to choose next. I'm gonna go with Ohan Dai. It is from a style known as Ryuei Ryu, which used to be this secret family style in Okinawa. And I remember practicing this when I lived there way back in the day with the headmaster Tsuguo Sakumoto Sensei. And this kata, Ohan Dai, didn't even exist back then. It was secret. But these days, more and more people are starting to publicly use it in tournaments and demonstrations. So for that reason, there are actually videos of it. And here is one of them. Ohandai is kind of a weird kata because you could see it as a combination of many other katas from this style of ryu-e-ryu, like paiku or heiku or anandai. And I consider it a very complex kata, but it's super fun to practice because it has such a wide variety of movements, directions, and techniques in it. For that reason, I'm putting it at
A level.
As you might notice, I haven't put anything at C, D, E, or F. And that's probably because I just love kata too much. I just want to put them all and stack them at the top. So that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Ah, we only have 2 left. Okay, let's see. If I only could choose 2 more, well then I would have to go with, first of all, papuden. This is what that kata looks like. Papuden in many ways is similar to Nippai Po in the sense that it is derived from white crane kung fu, but it is a far cry from its original version that I learned in China. In China, they said that this is one of the most important kata that you should study because it teaches you many of the same lessons that Sanshin does when it comes to breathing, but it also teaches you other things that are connected to qi cultivation or how to use your energy properly. But it doesn't matter whether you learn the modern Japanese karate version or the old school kung fu version. It has really cool and complex techniques that I think are beneficial for any stylist out there. For that reason, I'm gonna put it at the same level as Nippai Po because they share kind of that same characteristic quality. So it's an A-level kata for me. Now it's getting hard because out of all these kata, I gotta pick one more. Okay, wow, this is not easy. You know what? Actually, it is easy. I'm gonna go with one of the oldest historically verified kata that exist across every style of karate, and that is Seisan, or Hangetsu for those of you who practice Shotokan. Although my favorite version of Seisan is the one they do in Uechi-ryu karate, and this is what that version looks like. The reason I picked this kata is both for its technical and tactical qualities, but also for its historical significance, because it is one of the oldest verified documented kata, and it exists in almost every style of karate. And back in the days, it was actually the very first kata you would learn in Okinawa, regardless of your style, because it existed before styles even existed. And since I put Sanshin and Naihanshin Shodan as these fundamentally important kata at the B level before, I'm gonna put Seisan there as well. Now my question is, which kata would you like to learn? It could be either one of these kata or some other kata, because I would love to make a tutorial and teach you a kata from start to finish. Leave a comment and let me know. And then check out my other videos to learn even more about the origins, tradition, history, culture, philosophy of old and new karate, because there is so much to learn out there. Thank you so much for watching. Train hard, good luck, and have fun.